The People's Bank of China has cut key lending rates to further boost China's slowing economy. How will that impact today's trade? And joining us, of course, today for his take on the markets within the region and, of course, local markets, Mr. Ken Wong of East Spring Investments. Good morning, Ken. Welcome to Market Edge.
Morning.
Okay, let's talk about the China rate cut first. What's the impact of that?
Yeah, the rate cut was widely expected. The fact is that we've been seeing quite a bit of stimulus policies already happening over the past month or so. And the fact is that because China's economy, has been slowing down, we were widely expecting the fact that the central government, together with the PBOC, to be much more accommodative when it comes to both monetary as well as fiscal policies, in order to help really stimulate the economy, because this is one of the things which is going to be very important as we enter the second half of the year, is that how can the Chinese economy grow to the 5% target level, which was set forth earlier this year?
All right. We know for a fact that China is hit by GDP projections downgrades by several global lenders. Of late, we had Goldman Sachs joining the fray, with UBS and even JP Morgan expressing the same concerns. Now, full year GDP for China has been seen or is being seen to slip from 6 to about 5.4%. Now, as we have just over 6 months before the year ends, do you see any catalysts to bring about a reversal of this trend? The rate cuts may be one.
Yeah, I mean, the fact is that we're still estimating to see China's economy growing by anywhere between 5 to 5.5% for this year. Now, in particular, we have seen a rebound in consumption in China, but the fact is that overall manufacturing activities continues to to remain fairly weak, because the fact is that, we still are going through a destocking phase in China, in which there was a bit too much excess inventory over the past couple of years. But we feel that by the second half of the year, towards the third quarter, we feel some of that destocking will continue. And the fact is that more manufacturing activities will ramp up in the second half of the year, which should lead to a better second half when it comes to overall economic environment in China.
Okay, Mike, Ken, what happened to China? Because last year there was much excitement over the country's long-awaited reopening from stringent curbs, and then the growth slows down, dousing hopes for at least an immediate recovery, which everyone had expected to be sizable.
Yeah, China is a little bit different from other developed markets. The fact is that when you look at consumption as a percent of China's economy, it still only hovers between 55% or so, whereas most developed economies, their consumption as a percentage of their overall GDP is closer to about 75 to even 80% for some developed markets. So the fact that, yes, China had reopened at the end of last year, the fact is that consumption is still only one part of China's economy where, net exports is very important. Manufacturing is also very important. Overall fixed asset investments is also very important. So, these things do have to pick up, and that's why, the Chinese government is looking to be more accommodative in various areas in order to really help stimulate this. And of course, we know that, by actually trying to strengthen up the economy, that should lead to a better improvement in the second half of the year, where potentially you have more hirings, more corporates increasing their capital expenditures. So all these things we expect to happen in the second half of the year to help drive the economy.
Meantime, how is China's recession, or at least the economic slowdown, affecting neighboring Asian markets?
Well, there's definitely going to be some impact. The fact is that, overall, Chinese travelers around the world, are starting to travel to the rest of the world again, in particular in Asia. But the fact is that it's going to be very important to see, if you get a rise in China's economy, you would expect for a lot of the Chinese tourists to, spend a bit more when it comes to visiting other parts of the world, including, here in Asia. And so that's why it's going to be very important to see, as we enter the second half of the year, particularly when we enter the summer months, whether or not we see any meaningful recovery, which helps boost overall morale and sentiment from consumers, and which could lead to potentially a rise in spending, which could definitely help a lot of the various Asian economies.
Okay, going now, Ken, to China's neighbor, Japan. Well, Japan Times article is saying investors are putting big money in Japan again, with the country poised to recover its so-called lost decade. Now, Japan equities have done well, with the Nikkei 225 seeing a jump of 30% this year, performing much better, with highs not seen since the 90s. Now, add to that ultra-low interest rates. Why else are investors liking Japan?
Yeah, the fact is that when you look at Japan, there's a few very key things which is still going for it. In addition to, you know, what you alluded to earlier with low interest rates, you have a specific, you know, market where earnings yield are very attractive. An increase in share buybacks. You have more companies, especially the Japanese corporates right now, who are increasing their dividend payouts. And so overall, you know, when we look at the investment environment right now in Japan, it's still actually leading to a lot of good opportunities, despite like what you mentioned earlier, that the markets have gone up 30% already. But, you know, a lot of these are still, you know, sort of in the direction, in a very positive direction for a lot of Japanese corporates as they continue their expansions in terms of increasing productivity.
Okay, let's take a look now at ASEAN markets. Now, most bourses, including the Philippines, experiencing humongous outflows not seen since the 2008 financial crisis. Now, quoting Reuters data, the combined markets of Taiwan, India, Vietnam, Thailand, and even the Philippines and South Korea lost about $57 billion from pullouts. Now, how do you foresee emerging markets to recover and revert to inflow position?
Yeah, I think that also partially has to do with the strong dollar. The fact is that, you know, the dollar continues to be strong. The fact is that, you know, we're still getting signs that potentially the Fed could raise interest rates again, you know, one or two times, you know, by the end of this year. Or even if they don't raise interest rates, the fact is that interest rates at these current levels will remain for some time. That doesn't really bode well for emerging markets as a whole. But, you know, the fact is that when we look at emerging markets in this part of the world, you know, when we look at places like, you know, Taiwan and South Korea, they perform very well. Now, the ASEAN markets this year have given some of the gains that we saw previously, but when you look at markets like the Philippines, you know, relatively flat for this year. Singapore has also been relatively flat. So the fact is that, you know, there has been some money being withdrawn and, you know, being pulled out of some of the ASEAN markets in favor of some of the, you know, other emerging market Asian countries, you know, which had underperformed last year, in particular when we look at places like Taiwan or South Korea, especially, you know, sort of with this AI theme.
All right. Now, when you talk about foreign funds, these funds, of course, are leaving emerging markets, returning to developed markets like the United States. But we know not all seems well in the U.S. In fact, an article from your group, Positioning for U.S. Recession, speaks about several indicators pointing to a recession or an economic slowdown in the next 6 to 12 months. Now, what's the defensive game plan for those invested in the U.S. markets?
Yeah, I would say that specifically, you know, you have to be a bit more careful. Right now, we are underweighting the U.S. equity markets. The fact is that given where valuations are, you know, ultimately, when you look at the S&P 500, trades roughly around 17, 18 times earnings. The fact is that when you look at, you know, how much the markets have continued to appreciate, you know, we feel that any meaningful, let's say, slowdown in the U.S. economy, the fact that, you know, if let's say the U.S. dollar starts to weaken, we could potentially start to see a bit more of capital moving away from the U.S. and into some of the other markets which have underperformed. So, you know, we feel that, you know, because potentially of the high inflation rate, which potentially could stay for a longer period in the U.S., you know, with all these things I just mentioned earlier, that could have some negative impacts in the U.S. equity markets, at least in the short term, which could impact how overall performance is.
Okay, now we know that one of the critical variables there, and we're watching out for in the coming months for the U.S., is the effect of successive rate hiking, its impact on the economy, as this is not something that will immediately be felt. It's slow boil. Now, based on your study and projections, how severe will high borrowing costs actually hit the U.S. economy?
Well, it will have an impact, I would say, at least in the short term. The fact is that, you know, I think the recession word is, you know, it's, you know, can mean a lot of things. The fact is that even having a slight slowdown is also still considered to be a recession. So we don't see a, you know, sort of a massive slowdown in the U.S. economy because overall, when you look at the employment figures, it remains to be barely strong. And the fact is that, you know, we're still seeing a lot of U.S. companies, you know, still spending quite a bit of money when it comes to capital expenditures. But overall, we think that there could be a bit of a slight mild recession in which growth can, you know, sort of slow down for a couple of quarters. And the fact is that, you know, hopefully with that moderate slowdown, we could potentially start to see things turn around, you know, let's say in the next 12 to 18 months, once we do get a short period when it comes to things slowing down a bit, to try to really control the overall inflationary numbers, which still remains to be at elevated numbers in the U.S.
Okay, let's talk about the Philippine markets now. Equities in particular, which have been trading the range with low volumes. Now, these doldrums brought prices to the 12 PEX already attractive, if you look at it, for buying or adding to existing positions. Now, it's been a market that has defied positive indicators. We have cooling inflation, resilient industries have done well. Even the consumer market is up. Why are investors not liking Philippine shares?
Yeah, like I mentioned earlier, the fact is that there just seems to be more flows heading into some of the more themes that we're seeing right now within the EM Asia markets, you know, like Taiwan, like South Korea, you know, with that push towards AI. Now, that has been, I would say, a fairly strong global push, and hence that's why we've been seeing some of the assets being reallocated. But like what you mentioned earlier, the fact is that Philippine equity markets are trading at 12, 13 times earnings. The fact is that when you look at this year to date, it has, you know, performed fairly well relative to some of the other ASEAN markets, especially the emerging market ASEAN markets. And overall, when we look at earnings growth, it still remains to be fairly robust, because overall EPS growth estimations for this year is still roughly about 20%, which makes it, you know, sort of one of the top countries here in Asia. So there is still fairly strong fundamental signs. And, you know, as mentioned earlier, you know, with relaxation of monetary policies and lower inflationary numbers, you know, when we start to see some assets potentially moving away from some of the AI themes that we've been, you know, sort of talking about over the past 4 to 6 months, the fact is that you could start to see some flows heading back into the Philippines, you know, as investors start to reallocate and look for those opportunities for areas to invest in.
And lastly, Ken, are there bright spots you're seeing for the Philippine equities that would somehow buoy it through volatile months ahead?
Yeah, we still think that right now, you know, in the short term, you probably want to be in sort of more value defensive related stocks. But ultimately, in the longer term, we still very much like the conglomerates. You know, the financials continue still to be areas that we're investing in. So, you know, these remain to be areas that, you know, we continue to keep our eyes on.
All right. On that note, we thank you so much for joining us, Mr. Ken Wong, Client Portfolio Manager of East Spring Investments. Have a good day.
Thank you.